Ah, the Venus Series UM690, Minisforum's latest mini PC, making its rounds on YouTube. I know I'm a few weeks late to the party, but Minisforum did take a while to send out my pre-order. Nevertheless, we're here now, but make sure you like and subscribe, so that'll help me gain early access to mini PCs like this in future. So what is a UM690? If you're familiar with the Miniforum's offerings, it looks identical with the UM590. While the UM590 has a previous gen AMD Ryzen 5900HX with its Vega 8 graphics, which is pretty good as far as 720 gaming goes, this UM690 comes with the latest 6900HX with the 680M RDNA2 based integrative graphics, so it should be a huge leap forward in gaming, and it's touted to be the most powerful iGPU out right now. I'm super excited to go through the results with you because this could be the first integrated graphics solutions that is truly capable of 1080p. I'm going to run through some benches, test it as a Plex server, thermals, noise, and run some games on it. So let's see what this beast is made of. Firstly, this is what you get in the box. You've got a 60cm HDMI cable, a VESA mount bracket, a 120W power brick, which isn't the smallest, I'll put its dimensions up on screen, a SATA and power combo cable, a stand which is quite generous of them, spare rubber feet, and of course the unit itself. Now let's talk about the exterior of the unit, and I'm going to start at the bottom because, as I just mentioned, it comes with spare rubber feet, and here is why. In order to gain access to the unit, you actually need to peel off the rubber feet to access the screws. Look at my unit, it looks absolutely munted, and that is only removing it once. I have another set of RAM I want to test on this unit, meaning I'll have to open it up again in future. Poor design choice in my opinion. Other than that, you have two holes for the VESA mounting. Onto the rest of the unit, the entire unit is housed in black plastic with a Minisforum logo on a ribbed design top. The build feels average to me, maybe slightly below. Having owned Intel NUCs before, this feels one step below. On the sides you have grills for ventilation. Over on the front you have a clear CMOS button, a clicky power button, a 3.5mm combo jack, USB 4 which supports external GPUs, which I will test in a separate video, and a USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type-C that supports data only. Over on the rear you have a 19V DC port for power, a Kensington lock just to the left of the grill, below that is a 2.5 gigabit Ethernet port, then you have 4 USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type-A ports, and 2 HDMI ports supporting up to 4K 60Hz. After some fumbling about with the rubber feet and screws, we're in the internals now. Over on the other side of the rear plastic cover, you've got space for one 2.5-inch SATA drive. The SATA cable plugs into the white port just next to where the M.2 slot is. The slot supports 2280 sized NVMe drives at PCIe 4.0 speeds, which is fantastic. Beneath where the NVMe M.2 drive goes is a pre-installed MediaTek RZ608 M.2 Wi-Fi 6E and Bluetooth 5.2 combo card, which can be switched out with a different M.2 2230 card if needed. You've got your black CMOS battery, two DDR5 sodium slots running in dual channel, and for this review I'm running Crucial 4800MHz CL40 spec, which comes in at a fair price and is readily available too. There are some screws that can be removed to access the heatsink and fan, but we won't do it in this video as it's not a full teardown. Now let's cover off the specs. The UM690 has an AMD Ryzen 9 6900HX which has 8 cores and 16 threads on TSMC's 6nm FinFET architecture. It has a base clock of 3.3 GHz, boosts up to 4.9 GHz, and has 16MB of L3 cache. This CPU was announced in April this year, but we're only just seeing it pop up in mini PCs for purchase the last couple of months. The star of the show is of course the integrated graphics on this chip, the RDNA2 based AMD Radeon 680M which has 12 CUs and clocked at 2400MHz. Although we've already covered off, we have Crucial DDR5 sodium RAM at 4800MHz and a 256GB Patriot P300 NVMe SSD. My first intention was to use a Windows to Go USB, but had issues booting. It would get stuck on the Minisforum BIOS splash and not allow access to the BIOS, so I resorted to the NVMe SSD as intended. Also, with a fresh install of Windows 11 and finally booted, it doesn't actually detect the Wi-Fi card or the Ethernet port, forcing me to use a USB Ethernet adapter to go through the Windows setup. Alternatively, if you have another PC, you can go to the Minisforum website to download the relevant drivers and install it via command prompt. But if you're not so savvy, I recommend just going for a unit with a pre-installed drive. Before we get into the benchmarks, I've gone into the BIOS to see what is available to tinker. Looks like we can set the TDP and also the memory speed. I've done a quick test and found that increasing memory speed from 4800 to 5200MHz, I've been able to get better gaming performance, which makes sense as these integrated GPUs tend to scale well with memory speed up to 10% better average FPS in one game is what I observed. I've got faster memory on its way, which I will be doing a separate video doing a side-by-side comparison using different memory speeds. Also, I had an issue trying to increase the TDP to 65 watts. For some reason, it will just default back to 30. Auto will default to 54 watts at full load, so I've left it as it is. Firstly, let's do some benchmarks. Cinebench R20, we got a single core score of 471 and a multi-core score of 5,252. That's a pretty good score. The single core, I have to say, was slightly disappointing for latest gen and being slightly slower than a desktop class Intel 9th generation Core i5 and multi-core, which is similar to the 9th gen Core i9 given its core count. But do remember that the 6900HX is only rated as a 45 watt TDP CPU versus a 95 watt i9-9900K, so huge leaps in efficiency. Now Geekbench. 1321 single core and 9428 multi-core. That single core score is the same that you get from the last gen Ryzen 5800H, but does pull ahead in the multi-core score, and somewhere between the 9th gen i9 again and the 10th gen i9, and not too far from the desktop Ryzen 7 5700X as well. Overall, they are great scores for a mobile chip, and I always love having a look at how they perform against desktop class CPUs. Okay, it's time for the main course. Let's do some gaming. Let's dive in the deep end. Cyberpunk 2077, I run it at 900p low and got an average of 64 frames per second and a minimum of 12. That's a really good average, but the 12 frames per second minimum is a bit concerning, as it does mean in gameplay you may get the occasional stutter. I suspect that faster RAM might alleviate that, so we'll see in my next video. Call of Duty Modern Warfare 2 now. 1080p FSR on balance, we got an average of 92 frames per second. It does bring the render resolution down to 640p, which is a bit low, but you can change FSR to a more quality setting if you're okay with somewhere in between 60 and 92 FPS. Otherwise, great result here. Forza Horizon 5, 1080p low preset, we get an average of 75 frames per second. The benchmark did record some stutters despite it looking silky smooth to me. If you only have a 60Hz display, you may want to turn VSync on for a very solid experience. World War Z, 1080p medium settings, averaged at 60 frames per second with a low of 51. I do expect higher with this game, but regardless, still a great experience. You can always drop it down to low settings if you prefer a little bit more FPS. Lastly, GTA 5, 1080p normal preset. We get an average of 94 frames per second and a low of 52. As expected from an older title, the UM690 handles this game easily. Now onto Plex transcoding. I've got 3 HEVC copies of Tenet, 4K at 28.4 megabit, 4K at 4.2 megabit, and 1080p at 3.5 megabit. Now, of course, I'm not going to show any footage for copyright reasons. Going to this, I was pretty darn sure that 1080p is going to be no problem, but 4K and HDR with tone mapping turned on, well, I'm happy to report that yes, it can transcode the 4K 28.4 megabit file down to 1080p H.264 beautifully. It was able to handle two streams before maxing out the CPU at 100% and started to buffer at the third. Stepping it down to the 4K 4.2 megabit file, two streams brings CPU usage to a similar level, and performance was just shy of allowing for one more additional stream. At 1080p, expect to run up to 4 streams before maxing out the CPU. Now, do keep in mind this is an AMD chip and doesn't have Intel Quick Sync, which can handle many more 1080p streams, but at least the last Intel chip I tested, the Core i5-11320H with a 96 execution unit RSXE graphics, couldn't handle a single 4K HDR stream with tone mapping turned on. So in that regard, if you have less people accessing your Plex server and have 4K HDR content, this will serve you better. Now to power draw. At idle, this thing was pulling 11 watts from the wall and 82 watts at full load, but that was after spiking up to 90 watts. Temps were really good, never exceeding 72 degrees Celsius, but stayed under 70 for a majority of the time. Noise was also really good. It's audible at full load, but still kept within the 31 decibel ambient of my room from an arm's length away. If you're gaming with the speakers on, you will unlikely hear it. If you plan to mount this behind your monitor, which I do strongly suggest, it will be even less audible. At idle, it was near silent unless you do put your ear next to it. So that was the UM690. Now, how much does it cost? $499 for the bare bones, and if you step it up to the 16GB RAM and 512GB SSD, that's $649. They don't list out the RAM speed, which I assume is a run-of-the-mill 4800MHz. I will be doing a separate video with 5600MHz memory, which isn't too far away, so we'll be able to let you know if that extra cost is worth it. Otherwise, a 16GB kit of Crucial DDR5 at 4800MHz will set you back about $70 USD, and a budget 512GB NVMe SSD around $35. $1,000 for a total cost of $605. So you are better off picking those up yourself than a pre-spec'd version. Now my closing thoughts. This is, as of now, my favorite mini PC. Not even a competition. It gets nearly everything right, and most important, it is proof that we're at the iGPU 1080p Nirvana that we've been dreaming of until now. No doubt, I love the gaming performance of this unit, but I was also pleasantly surprised with its ability to handle two concurrent 4K HDR transcodes on Plex. All this, and it ran very quiet. From a personal standpoint, it has ticked all the right boxes for it to be my permanent Plex server. Now that doesn't mean it's perfect. As mentioned, the build of the unit is quite average, and also having to remove the rubber feet to access the internals is a letdown. Those who pick up this bare bones unit will also need to take note of downloading drivers with another device as part of the Windows 11 setup. Other than that, honestly, there isn't much else to nitpick on. Even the port selection on the unit really suits me. So then value, for an all-in price of the mentioned $605, it's actually good when compared to other units with the same 6900HX CPU, which tends to start at that price for a bare bones. The price is also comparable to the 12th gen i7 NUC, which the UM690 will clearly destroy in gaming. Everything else is a step down in graphical performance and price. So there's very little in the mini PC space that is competition to this. For the right person, this gets a highest recommendation from me. But that's all from me this time. I've got more videos of this unit coming up, so make sure you get subscribed. I'll see you then. Bye bye.